Barraclough left here to join Newcastle United in 1970 and returned late in February by way of Birmingham City and Bristol Rovers. The Oakwell fans also get their first look at Ray McHale, who has played in three away matches since being signed from Brighton for £55,000. Barraclough and McHale take their places in midfield alongside Ronnie Glavin, who shrugged off the groin strain which forced him to come off at Oxford on Tuesday night. For Billy Hamilton, it's back to the third division routine after the World Cup spotlight on Wednesday when he scored Northern Ireland's goal at Hampden Park. This Burnley side was actually selected a fortnight ago, since when they've had three games postponed. It includes four teenagers, Andy Wharton at right back, Vince Overson, the central defender, and Michael Phelan and Kevin Young in midfield. The experience comes from goalkeeper Alan Stevenson, Martin Dobson now in a defensive role, and the former Sheffield Wednesday forward, Eric Potts. Today's senior official is Ken Redfern from Whitley Bay. And Barnsley prepare to start their first home game for 5 weeks against Burnley, who haven't played anywhere for the last 3 weeks because of the bad weather. Barnsley distinguishable with the darker shirts and white shorts. Here's Joe Joyce for them. Players from both sides affirming before the game the importance of this one. Barnsley, in fact, haven't won in the third division since January the 16th. Here's Dobson. Seven is Kevin Young, who's naturally left-sided but's playing in the centre of Burnley's midfield today. There's Andy Wharton and now Stuart Robertson in backs in strongly. And the referee giving the free kick to Barnsley for a nudge on Aylott, taken by McHale. Dobson's header out, collected by Glavin. Ricocheting through to Alan Stevenson, who of course began his career with Chesterfield. The pitch really has dried out remarkably well, and the main problem for the players this afternoon is likely to be a gusty wind which is blowing from right to left. Out of Hamilton. Glavin. Overson sticking tight to Aylott, but too tight on that occasion. Derek Parker. Put in by Evans. Aylott jumping. It will come down for Barraclough. Time to bring the ball under control, but may not have had the call that he needed to be made aware of that. Early from Ian Evans, directed on by Trevor Aylott, and this was Barraclough's header that fell comfortably in the end for Stevenson. Here's Parker, and certainly Burnley making sure that they get their tackles in from the sort of balls that are played into the feet of Parker and Aylott, and a number of them in this opening 7 or 8 minutes have infringed the rules. So Chambers with the free kick. Evans is forward here, but forward unfairly. Ian Evans, the player coach here at Oakwell, and often an effective figure at set pieces. This time as Phil Chambers clipped it in. Evans jumping here with Hamilton. He's a judge to have pushed. The whistle had already gone before the ball reached Glavin. Aylott. Here's Chambers. Now Glavin, there's a chance here. Is in at the kill again. 13 minutes gone. Chambers threading the pass through beautifully, and Glavin, with that predatory nature of his, keeping his head, prodding it under Stevenson, and that's an important goal for Barnsley. And for Glavin, it's his 19th of the season. And here's Scott. And Hamilton. And this time Chambers is there to save his side, having created the goal. Barnsley grateful now to their skipper at the other end of the field. It came from Scott and Hamilton stretched out, but Chambers just poked it away. Hamilton. Here's Stuart Robertson. That's a free kick to Burnley. Foul by Glavin, who had a word to Mr. Redfern about the decision. He just made contact with little Stuart Robertson. Burnley have three players over the ball, and Scott and Young on the end of the wall. And out of your picture, Hamilton and Overson waiting to make their runs at the far post. And set for Dobson, and it's a corner. David Holt, the left back, is an important figure in Burnley's plans at these situations, and he's gone right onto the near post. So the decoy worked at the near post, and for Mickey Phelan, it's the delight of a first league goal. Burnley had three on the near post who distracted Pearce, and look at the room that was left for the free header from Phelan. So Barnes' lead lasted just 3 minutes. Parker, now Barraclough, Glavin setting off on a sprint through the middle, Aylott on the far post. Banks has got forward again, but it was aimed for Aylott, who was inches away. Always trying to drift away behind his marker. And Barraclough, after assessing the options and cutting it back onto his left foot, looked to try and pick out Trevor Aylott. He stretched, but stretched in vain. Paul Glavin, who reacts so quickly again. And Dobson with the saving header. And Glavin's capacity to sense openings quicker than those around him. Again, making him stand out in this game. And it's Kevin Young who takes the steam out of the situation with the back pass. Spoken to by Mr. Redfern. Kevin Young, meanwhile, had his name taken. Andy Wharton had been hurt in the challenge that Young was protesting about. McCarthy going in strongly. Wharton went down and Young was protesting. Certainly looking to play football from the back. And a free kick to Burnley. Always a club, of course, with stylish traditions about their football, Burnley, and here's Potts. And Scott couldn't quite reach it. Perhaps Young can here. Robertson. Set up for Scott. It's 2-1 as Barnsley appeal for handball. The linesman is unmoved. Derek Scott with 9 minutes to go of this first half, puts Burnley in front in controversial circumstances. The move building up on the right with the cross from Potts, and it was Scott who couldn't quite reach it in the first place. Young managed to pivot well here to turn it back to Robertson, and it was there that the hand appeared to be used, but the flag stayed down, the referee didn't spot it, and Derek Scott drilled it past Gary Pearce. Here's Hamilton, fencing his pace against Evans. Potts is in the middle, Hamilton might do it himself. And with the sight of glory opening up for him, he couldn't find the target. But clearly, with pace to spare against Evans, with options opening up for him in the middle, he'd been trying to stab it across but was off balance as he made contact. And it's the end of the afternoon for Phil Chambers, who ironically is as his only ever present this season, and Glyn Riley, who has always been such a versatile performer for them, comes on again as substitute. So the end of the first half, in which the key figure really is Stuart Robertson. The question as to whether he handled in the move that led to him setting up the second goal for Burnley for Derek Scott. This after Burnley had gone behind to Ronnie Glavin's 19th goal of the season and found an equaliser through Michael Phelan. So first half full of tension in this third division promotion race. And a half-time score, it's Barnsley 1, Burnley 2. Against them in 1971 and marked that first division debut with a goal. Well, certainly Barnsley could use a goal from him in the second half, which begins positively for them from Glavin. And here's Glyn Riley. Banks. Robertson. Barnsley will have what help the wind is giving with them in the second half. McHale. Joyce. Maylett always struggling to get his balance to direct the header back across the goal. Presents it straight to Kevin Young. And Potts using it quickly for Scott to chase. Pearce, nice spot of juggling. Glavin. Caught by Scott, and feeling that he should have got the free kick, and Ronnie Glavin. It's a side sight for Barnsley followers. Comfort from the free kick, but Glavin is still down, his ankles were clipped, and if looks could kill, but he might just be interested in this situation. So often the key man for free kicks around the edge of the box for Barnsley, Glavin, and suddenly there's an extra spring in his stride. And he very nearly gets away with a quick free kick while the referee was still talking to Ian Evans. So Glavin or maybe Banks will get a second bite at it. Mr. Redfern wants the five-man ball on the wall. Back the full distance. Oh, here's Glavin again. This time using guile rather than power. And he couldn't keep the chip down. In the end, it was a still left to Glavin. He got it up over the wall, over Stevenson and over the bar. McHale was sensibly done, resisting the temptation just to pump it forward. Joyce, and the trick by Overson leads to the book being produced. Joyce coming forward more and more in the second half, and they'd slip Vince Overson here. McHale with the free kick. Aylott flicking it on well, and Glavin couldn't turn it in. They always seem to have a man over in this attack. And then Aylott taking on Wharton, who just flicked him around the ankles. Mr. Redfern well positioned to give the penalty. And it's Ian Banks. An important moment for Barnsley's promotion chances. The youth of Banks against the experience of Stevenson. And the youngster comes out on top. And 14 minutes into the second half, it's 2-2. Stevenson, slightly wrong-footed at the start and couldn't readjust. Banks takes his total of the season to 15, and that's his fourth penalty. Here's Barraclough. Joyce and Wharton making a clearance that in the end was irrelevant because the linesman was flagging for offside. Responsible for a slightly larger than average attendance of 14,000. Banks this time with the long throw. Aylott's flick, Glavin's header. Head, and it was just touched by Glavin, who got no power into it. Aylott, the header from Holt. Here's McHale. Barraclough again against David Holt. And Aylott seemed to have a clear header, and he felt that Phelan was pushing him, and certainly there was contact between Phelan and Aylott as Aylott headed the ball. At the very least, it rather spoilt Aylott's aim. Into the back of him as the header went wide. Joyce. Glavin. Here's Parker. take on Wharton, and then using Joyce, and Scott a little slow getting back with him. Parker setting up McHale, and bobbled its way through. And Mickey Phelan limping again. Phelan's injury. Barraclough. Blocked by Overson and Banks. Probably been on target, but I don't think there was any way Stevenson could have got across to keep it out. And Stevenson positioning himself originally for Barraclough's shot. And Banks was aiming for his right hand post. Put it wide of the goal and the goalkeeper, and the expected substitution will shortly take place for Kavanagh, who's 19 and is an orthodox winger. He's there with the Burnley manager Brian Miller, and Mickey Phelan, a painful ending to a game that he'll never forget though, which has brought him his first goal in the Football League. And the word from the Burnley manager Brian Miller is that it's a badly twisted ankle for Michael Phelan, which is already strapped. Takes the free kick quickly. Barraclough. And the header from Parker, but again the cheers turn to groans from the Barnsley throats. McHale's quick free kick had set Barraclough on his way. Clavin was offside, and so too was Parker as the ball reached him. And the whistle had gone as Glavin used his arms to put it into the net. Both sides found themselves appealing for a free kick, which in the end is given in Barnsley's favour. Glavin and McHale and Banks all over the ball. And in the end, it's going to be left for Banks. Well, how about that? A minute from normal time. The Burnley wall disintegrates. Ian Banks thunders in a goal that may well have decided this match, but more than that, might have put Barnsley back on course again. So Barnsley end that run of 10 weeks without a league win. And Ian Banks is the man of the hour. His penalty getting Barnsley on even terms 14 minutes into the second half. But when a draw looked an absolute certainty, his 25-yard free kick bringing delight to the supporters at Oakwell. Burnley, who had contributed so much and led after Michael Phelan and Derek Scott had scored for them in the first half, following Ronnie Glavin's opening goal to the game, but pipped at the last. And and they may look to this match as a turning point in their season, where promotion ebbed away from them. But here at Oakwell, they believe they're still going up. Final score, Barnsley 3, Burnley 2.
Ian, can I start by taking you back to half-time when you'd gone a goal behind? What was the feeling about that goal in the dressing room?
Well, I thought we'd had done by, really, because I thought their player handled the ball.
That was Stuart Robertson.
Yeah. He stuck it in with that was it.
There was no doubt in the Barnsley players' mind that the goal, you felt, shouldn't have stood.
No, it shouldn't, no. Everybody feels it.
And the other thing, of course, that had happened just before the interval was Philip Chambers going off, and that meant you playing at left back. What sort of experience have you had there?
None at all. None at all. Never played there for.
Well, you seem to fit naturally enough to it.
No, I don't know about that.
Well, of course, you had time to get forward and decide the game, really. Let's talk about the penalty first. Now, you were taking it in preference to Ronnie Glavin today.
Well, yeah. Ronnie got injured, and I took over. And I ain't missed one, like, so Gaffer says keep taking him.
Now, you were facing a very experienced goalkeeper in Alan Stevenson. What was your thought as you approached the ball?
Well, we being left-handed, like, I thought to be his strongest side. But he changed my mind at last minute, and I just stuck it in that corner.
So did you change your mind?
Yeah, I did, yeah.
And then, of course, a minute from time, Barnsley got this free kick. Now, take us through that.
Well, we just got a free kick, and well, Ray McHale, he says, it's too far out, no, don't take it. I just thought he flooded and hit it. Get in.
Martin, it was obviously a sickening moment to lose the game in the dying minutes, but what was the Burnley view of the incident that led to the free kick?
Well, obviously, I was involved with that, so I had a close-on view of it. And the ball just played down the middle. It was a hopeful pump down the middle. And I timed my jump and header, and that was it. And the next minute, he blew for a free kick. Obviously, for me, I wasn't quite sure whether he blew for a push in the back on Parker or whether it was handball. But the only person who hands it was Parker. And I mean, from my point of view, there's no way I fouled him because I timed it and he backed into me.
And there's no doubt left it any later to pick up their first win in the third division for 10 weeks. A lot. Here's Chambers. Now Glavin, there's a chance here. And Ronnie Glavin is in at the kill again. And the header from Phelan. Always a club, of course, with stylish traditions about their football, Burnley, and here's Potts, and Scott couldn't quite reach it, perhaps Young can here. Robertson set up for Scott. It's 2-1 as Barnsley appeal for handball. A lot's touch, and Riley has got behind Wharton here. A lot, this looks promising for Barnsley. A lot is tripped, penalty. The youngster comes out on top. Glavin and McHale and Banks all over the ball. And in the end, it's going to be left for Banks. Well, how about that?
Well, then on Tuesday, in front of a splendid crowd of 20,000, Barnsley picked up an important away point away at Sheffield United. Barnsley playing in an unusual change strip of blue shirts and white shorts, and they got the boost of an early goal at Bramall Lane, set up here by Ronnie Glavin and Glyn Riley coming in to score. But half an hour from the end, Sheffield United sent on John Matthews for his first appearance since an injury in October. Matthews on for Mike Trusson. And 10 minutes from time, Matthews showed that he'd lost none of his shooting power, really drilling the ball here past Gary Pearce, and the final score 1-1.
Having secured promotion to Division 2, that's for the first time since 1959. Well, afterwards, Barnsley manager Norman Hunter joined his players for the celebrations. But last night was just the finale to a very hard season indeed for the club. A season which Barnsley supporters will remember for some pretty spectacular goals.
A lot. Here's Chambers. Now Glavin, there's a chance here. And Ronnie Glavin is in at the kill again. Cahill and backs all over the ball. And in the end, it's going to be left for Banks. Well, how about that?
Well, with us in the studio, we have the still bubbling Norman Hunter. Norman, welcome and great congratulations. How did you actually manage to lift the players last night after their shock defeat against Blackpool on Saturday?
Well, I didn't really need any lifting with playing Rotherham, with Rotherham being already promoted and looked like being champions. It was an ideal situation for us to go out and get 2 points, and that's how the lads reacted to it.
And I gather there's a sunshine bonus now for the squad.
Well, yes, we give them this little bit of incentive that if we did get promotion, that we'd go to Florida. So we're off to Florida for 10 days on about the 11th. But that was only if we went up. If we didn't go up, we'd go nowhere.
How did you feel last night when the final whistle went?
Well, I felt tremendously relieved. I sat there for the last quarter of an hour, and I've never experienced anything like that in my life. It was the longest quarter of an hour I've ever known. And a few decisions went against us, and I was a bit worried that they were going to score and equalise. But the boys held out, and they were absolutely tremendous on the night, and they thoroughly deserved the win.
You must have aged years in those last few minutes.
The last quarter of an hour was awful. I've been fortunate to have done not bad in the football, but I've never experienced anything like that because I couldn't do anything about it.
Now, Ronnie Glavin got the all-important goal last night, but I hear, and I read in this morning's papers, that he's still saying he wants to leave the club.
Well, Ronnie and I have had this arrangement now for a few weeks now that he would stay at the end of the season to try and get us promotion, and we've achieved that. And I said that if he wanted to leave, then he could. I don't want him to go, but Ronnie wants to improve himself, get a higher grade, so I'm willing to let him go.
Let's just look back over the season. You, of course, took over in October when Alan Clark came to Elland Road. Did you make many changes? Did you feel you had to make changes when you arrived?
Well, I didn't have to make changes, but I had to change the team's way of playing. You know, every manager's got his different views on how the game should be played, and mine are no different. And that's what I did. I changed the staff, brought my own staff in, played my way, and we've been rather successful.
You certainly have. What about next season, Norman? What's it going to be like playing in the second division?
Well, I said this to them before the Rotherham game. We've got the opportunity of going to places like Crystal Palace and Leicester, who are coming down, and Newcastle, and these teams, and Sheffield Wednesday, with a bit of tradition. And it'll do the players good to go to these places, and it'll improve their personal performances, and it's only good for Barnsley.
You have got a great squad at the moment, but do you think you'll have to buy in some more players?
Well, if people leave, if Ronnie leaves, then I'll have to look at the situation and see if I have to replace him.
And what about the money to do that?
Well, there's money there for me, which everything I've asked the board to do, they've allowed me to do it, but we've been rather successful. So if I need the money, it's there for me.
Norman, the very best of luck next season, and congratulations again. We're just going to have a bit of champagne, actually, because we think it's an occasion that certainly merits it.
Good
so,
idea.
Oh, it's already been poured out. Marvellous.
Well done.
So
Norman,
do take a glass. And again, congratulations and well
Thank
done.
You.
Good
Cheers,
luck
Richard.
Next season. Cheers. Not bad at all. Not bad at all.
Not bad at all. Are we going to finish that?
It's costing us a fortune in champagne. First time for 22 years. Barnsley season began under Alan.